Hi, I'm Richard Bolderbeek. I'm a postdoc in MIMI, the group in Groningen, and I want to present some work I want to be doing, which is about how to measure natural selection on pathogen evasion, and in this case it's evasion of the immune system by the pathogen. And the pathogen in this case will be a virus, and the host will be a human. In this presentation, it's an RStudio presentation. That means that I'll be actually running the code, and that's great. And also, for example, here some code is run. Cat means put on screen. 1 plus 1 is 2. It will calculate that and put the number 2 on there. So all the results are also that everything I show is real. I'll be using a library called BBBQ, which is the Bianchi, Bilderbeek, Borchardt question, which are the two jolly good people I work together with in this group. So with the biology, I want to talk about the arms race, the evolutionary arms race in the immune system. So here we have some B cells, here we have a neutrophil, here we have a virus, here we have a bacterium. And we can imagine that the pathogens, they evolve in such a way to avoid detection by the immune system, whereas the immune system is selected to detect as much pathogens as possible. And the research question is very simple. Can we detect that they do evolve to avoid host detection? So here we have again have a virus, and this talk is about only a virus for now. And here they have these codes, so they're undetected and they will take off their codes. But we can imagine that they do evolve to avoid host detection. And we can detect natural selection in pathogens. For example, this is a recent preliminary research on COVID-19. And there are these two loci that are strongly selected for being the same. So there's some conservation in there. But there are no loci. Yeah, perhaps this and that selected to change a bit, but it's not very strong. So we can detect natural selection in pathogen. Sadly, we cannot detect natural selection caused by host evasion. So these selected proteins are important for the virality of COVID-19. It's not selected to avoid a host. And there's this other study, study 2, in which they looked especially for that in influenza with 25,000 people. And they saw that a mutation did not give a higher detection in the host. At least they could not detect it. And I think that's because they used the whole immune system and they didn't focus their research as much as I'll be doing. Because I'll be focusing, and it's reasonable, because vital loci, the loci in pathogens that are selected for or conserved, are about virulence. And these are rare. As we can see in COVID-19, there are only five that we can detect. So there are only five loci that are really vital, that you can count on that they're there. But these vital loci, they differ between pathogens. So that our immune system would select on detecting these very rare loci is very unlikely. So therefore, the detection of these vital loci is unlikely. So that their selection on it is unlikely. But we can focus on transmembrane helices. So TMHs, they're proteins. They span the lipid bilayer in humans or pathogens as well. They span the lipid bilayer. They at least go through it once. I will focus on alpha helices, but there's also another TMH that there's also another way to span the membrane. It at least goes through the membrane once to be a TMH. We can predict from a protein sequence if it is a TMH. And we know that 25% of the human proteome is anchored in the membrane. So at least goes through it once it's anchored in it. But of course, there are also membrane proteins. So these general structures, it's more likely that we can detect selection when focusing on only those, because also all pathogens have them. So these are things you can select on. So the cool thing about TMHs, we can predict that they're TMHs and they're general, and they also have some restrictions in what they are. So it's a narrow, it's not that all mutations are equally, are neutral, because they must remain their function. They must maintain their function. So focusing on only TMHs, perhaps we can detect this. So what we want to detect is we take a data set, and from each polypeptide fragment, let's say of 20 amino acids, we can predict if it's detected or undetected by the immune system. And if we take a mutation, then it may be that it from a state remains the same state, or from a state changes, let's say that goes from detected to being undetected, or the other way around, that from undetected state it will become detected by the immune system, or that it remains undetected. So if evolution would select on going from detected to unselected, if we can detect a signal of the pathogen avoiding detection, then we expect to observe this more often than the others. So we need to count the number of observations we see in nature, and we can calculate the chance of observing that many transitions. And if this chance is less than 5%, we claim that there is selection working upon it. We could use other values, but let's use 5% because we have no idea. Well, measuring the observed numbers is easy. You take a strong data set, for example, this is COVID-19, has 3,000 sequenced genomes. It's also at multiple times, so we can detect individual mutations. If you use that, you can simply count the state transitions because we can predict when a polypeptide fragment is detected, and we can predict if it's not detected by the immune system, and then we simply count them. That's the easy part. But what we want to need to do is calculate how likely we will observe this number of observations given by chance. So let's do this for one amino acid fragment of a transmembrane helix. Here we have one. It's a randomly generated one. And we can predict if it's detected. With detected, I mean by MHC1 and MHC2. So if one of the two detects it, I define it as being detected. But then we can, from this sequence, we can calculate all its mutants that means they differ in one amino acid. And we can calculate the chance that such a mutant is detected when it's a transmembrane helix, when it's a mutant. So that means that of this polypeptide fragment, 97% of the mutants will be detected. And this polypeptide was detected. So that means a 97% chance it will remain detected. And we can do that for all transmembrane helix mutations. And then we can calculate how likely it is we find this. So I'll show you an example result. These are two, a null hypothesis and an alternative hypothesis. So let's say we find this number of observation and these chances to observe this. If these values are high, then we say, well, there's no or weak selection. We can't detect it. But if we find some chances that are lower, for example, this would fit the hypothesis best. If the number of transitions from detected to going to undetected, if this amount of observations is very unlikely by chance, we say, hey, we detected selection. So that's what my research will be about. There were some things I left out, for example, the exact calculation. I just showed you one number, but in the supplement, I have the complete calculation. Of course, humans have multiple haplotypes. In this example, I just used the alphabetically first ones. Also, I define being detected by being detected by either MHC1 or MHC2, but I will actually split those because I will also look at humans and bacteria. So for viruses, we expect both MHC1 and MHC2 to act upon. But for bacterium, MHC1 is unimportant because it does not insert its DNA in the host, so it's not presented. It won't present its DNA by MHC1. So this is a bit of a control. And also we can imagine for humans that they are selected to present these pathogens. So that concludes my presentation. So if you have questions, you can always send me an email if you want to talk about this, if you think I've overlooked stuff. You can also find this presentation online at GitHub, and you can also find this video. And that concludes this video, and I wish you a very good day. Hi, diehards. I will show you the exact calculation of my research. So which are the mathematics of it? So part one is the statistics. So let's say I know the chance to observe a mutation. So that's a given. How I will be determining how to observe all the mutations together. And part B is, how do I exactly observe one mutation? So for the statistics is how, so let's say I find this number of transitions and this is the number of observed of those transitions. What is the chance that I observe this given by chance if I know the chance of each of those 1,000 transitions? Well, for that, if we know per mutation what its probability is, then we can calculate the success or the transition rate or how likely it is to change or is to be successful. Then we can calculate the probability for all the mutations observed to happen, which is known as a Poisson binomial distribution. So if all these probabilities were equally likely, then I would just use a binomial distribution, like how likely is it to count to observe 10 times a 6 by 60 dice throws. That would be binomial. But in this case, these probabilities are different. And that's why we have to use a Poisson binomial distribution. So for example, we observe of 4 mutations, we calculate the chance that they transition, and we observe these successes, which is very weird already, because here we say the chance of success is 1, we observe a false. Well, that can theoretically happen, so I'll leave it in, because it's just about showing the statistics. So if you observe this, then we can calculate the chance to observe this. For example, the chance to observe 0 or less mutations is 0, because we always expect at least 1. Well, that's reflected by this part. The chance to observe 1 or more mutations is 1, because we are certain to expect 1 success at least, which is actually not the case, but that's irrelevant for this example. So you see that all these numbers are all above 0.05. So what we observed here, we observed 1, 2 successes. So that's very likely to have happened. So here I say that nothing special has happened, which is true because I drew these successes just randomly. So that concludes the statistics method. So if I find a value that's less than 0.05, it can be in both cases. So if it's more mutations than I expect by chance, or less mutation than I expect by chance. If that's less than 0.05, I say that selection will work on it. This part is to focus on just calculating that chance. How likely is it that the mutation causes a pathogen to become or remain un or detected? So that has some parts. So we can already, if we see a mutation from a polypeptide fragment, this fragment called F of focal, we know if it is detected. And of its mutants, we want to just count how many of them are un or detected. And that's easy. We collect all the possible mutants, the polypeptide fragment. So this polypeptide is 20 long. That means we'll have 380 mutants that differ in one amino acid. But not all of them are transmembrane helices, so I'll remove those that are not transmembrane helix, because I assume that if the pathogen loses the functionality of the transmembrane helix, the protein loses its function. So it's more or less as if it's a lethal mutation. So of all those mutants, I predict, using software again, if they're un or detected. And then still here, up until now, I've assumed that all mutations are just equally likely, which is false. So we have to correct for the AA transition rates, the amino acid transition rates, because some amino acids are present more, are coded more often in the nuclear code than others. So these are the three steps, and I'll show you. So we have our focal sequence F. Then we can get the adjacent sequences called ANTs. And those will be 380, so the number of characters, which is 20, of that focal sequence times 90, because there are 20 amino acids, but going from a character to another amino acid There are only 19 left, so that's why this will be 380, and we expect to find as much adjacent sequences then as there are possible. And here I show four of them, just randomly. Just did you have an idea? These are four of the neighbors. For each neighbor, so here I just pick a random neighbor called N. This is how it looks like. We can predict if it's a transmembrane helix, and we keep them. Only the transmembrane helix neighbors we keep. And then we can count if it's detected. That's great. But we should not simply count the number of un- or detected neighbors, because there's one more part of it, and that's the transition rate, because not all mutations are equally likely. For example, going from an A to W is less likely than going from an A to a V. So adenine, tryptophan, it's only encoded in the genetic code once, whereas valine more often. And also, it may be in a virus you have different transition, different values than just expected by chance. So I use a transition rate from a different virus to estimate that. And then I can predict when I take the transition rates into account. So here I have my focal sequence again, and I have the neighboring sequence here again, then I can get the transition rate from focal to neighbor, which is this, so it's a very unlikely transition. And then I just calculate per neighbor the rate at which it's mutating to being detected or not. And then I know the chance P that the mutant changed its state. For example, here I have, let's assume there are only three mutants, and this one is undetected. This also is undetected, and this one is detected. Then you can see there were eight possibilities to go undetected, and there are two possibilities to go detected. Those are rates, so it's a speed. So the chance to go to detected is only with a rate of two of the complete rate of 10, so that is 1/5. So that's how I can calculate the chance that the mutant is detected. So these are the references I've used in my presentation. This is a preliminary one. This is the amino acid substitution model in influenza. And these are the images attributions. So I hope you enjoyed my statistics, and I wish you a very good day.